Hello, I'm Jill at engVid, and today we have a lesson on some vocabulary, and it's all connected with climate change. So, if you probably know a lot about this subject already, but if English isn't your first language, then this might be useful for you to teach you some of the main terms which are used in English to do with climate change, which is also called global warming, because the problem is that the temperature is rising gradually but definitely. So climate change is to do with global warming, the temperature rising. Okay. And one of the main reasons for it is that for many years now, we've been using what are called fossil fuels, which are things like oil and gas and coal. And I think coal goes back a very long time, more than 100 years, and causes a lot of air pollution. Okay, so the fossil fuels are the things we need to try to stop using. And to stop, especially mining for coal, no more digging coal out of the ground and burning it for power. Okay, because all of those produce CO2, which is the chemical formula for carbon dioxide, which goes into the atmosphere and it just makes things warm up even more. What are called greenhouse gases. If you think of a greenhouse, which is a sort of glass house that you grow things in, things like tomatoes, fruit, other plants that like a warm atmosphere. So in a greenhouse, which is made of glass, that the glass and the light and the sunlight coming through the glass helps to keep it warm inside. So that's why we have this kind of metaphor, greenhouse, to describe the kind of gases such as CO2, which contribute to global warming. Okay, so all of this is described as a threat to human life, meaning human life is in danger because of all this climate change which is going on. And not just to human life, but also the loss of species, which can either be plants or animals or things like the coral reefs under the sea. A lot of those different species are becoming extinct. Coral reefs are sort of disappearing. So all these things that we're losing, it's not a good thing for the environment. Okay, so, and one term that's used, a result of climate change, is extreme weather, which can be all sorts of extremes. It can either be too wet or too dry. So too hot. I think too cold, I don't think that's one of the extremes so much, but definitely things getting too hot. Heat waves, when you have a very high temperature, more than 40 degrees temperature. Some countries are going into 50 degrees. So that's called a heat wave when it's so hot. You can hardly go outside, you can't walk, you might feel faint, you might collapse because it's so hot. So, heat waves. This word is pronounced drought. It's a strange spelling, but a drought is when there is no water, there's no rainfall, so everything dries up and you can't grow crops. Things like that. So drought. But then the opposite, storms, where you have heavy rainfall, So those are the extremes, very dry or very wet. Storms, hurricanes, when you have a very strong wind coming. And then because if it's very dry and hot, you're more likely to get wildfires, which are fires that might just start for no reason. Or it may be somebody has thrown a match on the ground and the grass has started to burn and the fire spreads. But sometimes a fire can just start almost on its own. And then they spread in an area with a lot of trees. The trees are very dry. In places like Australia, California, there are very often wildfires, and the fires just spread and spread. If the trees are there, the fires will just spread, and people with houses in those areas, they often lose their homes. Their homes burn down as well. Okay, so that's wildfires. If it does rain very heavily, you get floods. So people go out and they've got water coming up to their knees or even higher, or they can't go out at all because the water is so high. So floods. And scientists think that even volcanic eruptions, if you think there are a lot more volcanic eruptions nowadays, if you think, oh, there seems to be another volcanic eruption every few months, is it more than usual? Scientists think that even volcanic eruptions could be a result of global warming. It's a theory, I think, at the moment, but it's partly to do with the if there were glaciers on a mountain, the ice, the glacier, a big sheet of ice, if that melts, and they do melt, the weight of the glacier pressing on the volcano possibly helps to stop the volcano erupting. But if the weight of the glacier has gone, there is less weight pressing down, and that may be part of the, you know, likelihood of an eruption. So that's another thing. So rising sea levels, the sea rising, partly with ice melting, and then if you have smaller islands in places like the Pacific Ocean, there are a lot of little small islands. They could disappear completely if the sea level comes up high enough. Islands will be just lost. So the melting ice, is a lot of it is in the North Pole, the Arctic, and the South Pole, the Antarctic. And it's the melting ice, and very big pieces of ice break off and float around in the sea and gradually melt, and they're helping to raise the level of the sea, which is another danger. Okay. And then the other way is, again, so if it's very dry, what used to be farmland where people grow crops for food, the farmland could go very dry and turn into a desert. So it may have looked very green at one time, and then you see it looks sort of yellow or brown, and you can't grow anything there unless you have water to water it with regularly. So farmland becoming desert, then you can't grow crops. So that will then lead to food shortage. Not enough food for everybody, okay? So you may wonder, well, what can we do about it? What are the contributing factors? Well, two of them are to do with transport and things that we do at home. So transport, travelling by plane, by car, adds a lot to the global warming because of the fuel that's being used. If, you know, the planes have fossil fuels to power them, and cars have either diesel or petrol, which is fossil fuel again. And there's a trend now to make a lot more electric cars where that will be less harmful to the environment. Okay. But then if you avoid planes and cars and go use public transport instead, or walk if you don't have too far to go, then that's one thing that can be done. Okay. And then at home, household appliances, electrical equipment, heating, the heating in your house. If it's gas, then it's a fossil fuel. And then if your house doesn't have, or your home doesn't have insulation, if the heat that you have in the house can escape through cracks in the window or in the door, if it's drafty, so you have to turn the heating up to keep warm, then that's a bad thing. So another good thing that we can do is insulation. For example, double glazing for windows, two sheets of glass in the window rather than one, and things like that. Okay, so that's just a very short summary, really, of climate change, global warming, and some of the vocabulary connected with it. So I hope that's been helpful for you. And there will be a quiz on this, so please go to engVid.com and try the quiz. And see you again soon. Okay, bye for now.